Hi everyone, welcome to Bodyworks Prime. Today we're going to be going over the different muscle fiber types. From a very basic level, we have slow twitch fibers and fast twitch fibers. And fundamentally, the slow twitch fibers are going to be more in endurance type work, and the fast twitch fibers are going to be used in more strength type work. So before we start going into more detail about the different types of muscle fibers, let's discuss what a muscle fiber actually is. So we've got the skeletal muscle right here, and then inside the skeletal muscle, we have these little bundles which are called fascicles. And you can see one of the fascicles which is being pulled out from the skeletal muscle here. And inside the fascicle, you can see more bundles. And these bundles would be the muscle fiber itself. And you can see the muscle fiber which has been pulled out, and then we can break that down further with the myofibrils which are inside the muscle fiber. And then we have the sarcomeres, which are inside the myofibrils. Another interesting thing which I just wanted to point out as well is that within the fascicle here, obviously we've got all the different muscle fibers, but all of these muscle fibers aren't necessarily going to be of the same type. So usually you'll have a mix of slow twitch and fast twitch fibers within the same fascicle. But the ratio can differ between muscles and between individuals as well. Now the slow and fast twitch fibers can be further broken down into different categorizations. The slow twitch fibers are also called type 1 fibers, and the fast twitch fibers are also called type 2 fibers. And there's two different categories of type 2 fibers. We have type 2A and type 2X. Now these pictures here on screen are organized by the type of muscle fibers which are going to be used the most in these particular activities. So on the left here, this person's running maybe an endurance event like a marathon or something like that. The person in the middle, not running as fast as possible, but it's a medium distance running event. And then the person on the right hand side here, they're running as fast as they can, they're sprinting all out, trying to use as much strength, power, and speed as possible. And when I first started learning about these names and the differences between these muscle fibers, I often used to get the type 1 and type 2 muscle fibers jumbled up. I'm going to give you a way which you can really easily remember the difference between these names and which type of fibers relate to what type of activities. So type 1 muscle fibers would be the first type of muscle fibers that you use in everyday life. So say if you're just picking up a cup off the table or something like that, you would use your type 1 fibers. And this is because the type 1 fibers are more efficient for the body to use. So it's going to use them first. And you can tie that into slow twitch as well, because when you're picking up that cup off the table, you don't need a really fast and powerful movement. You just need a nice slow contraction of the muscle. So type 1 fibers, they'd be the first type of muscle fibers that you use because they're slow and efficient. You can use a similar principle to remember the difference between type 2A and type 2X fibers. Obviously A comes before X in the alphabet, so you can use that to remember that the type 2A fibers are used before the type 2X fibers because the type 2A fibers are more efficient than the type 2X fibers. The type 2X fibers would only need to be activated when extreme amounts of speed and power and strength are required. And I just want to point out here that the type 1 fibers don't just turn off and then the type 2 fibers take over. It's more that they work together. So let's say that you're running an endurance event and you've been using mostly your type 1 fibers, and then you're approaching the finish line and you start sprinting as hard as you can to get to that finish line. In that kind of situation, the type 1 fibers are still going to be working, but we've also got the type 2 fibers now, which are working alongside the type 1 fibers to provide that extra speed, strength, and power. And just because you're doing endurance work doesn't mean that it's only type 1 fibers which are being worked as well. There's still going to be involvement of the type 2 fibers even when you're doing endurance work. It's just the type 1 fibers are going to be used more. So let's take a closer look at the qualities of each type of muscle fibers. We'll start with the type 1 fibers. These fibers possess a high capacity for oxidative metabolism. This means they primarily use oxygen to produce their energy. They also have a rich supply of mitochondria, which you might remember from school. They're the cellular powerhouses, essentially. They also have an abundant amount of myoglobin, which is, on a basic level, a protein that's helping to supply oxygen. This myoglobin is what gives these muscle fibers their characteristic red color. So these type 1 fibers are more red in color than the type 2 fibers. Due to the presence of numerous blood vessels supplying these muscle fibers, this ensures a steady supply of oxygen to them. And as I just mentioned, these particular fibers are using oxygen to help produce their energy. Due to these features, the type 1 fibers are very fatigue resistant compared to the type 2 fibers, so they can sustain activity for more prolonged periods. They're predominantly engaged in endurance activities like long distance running, where strength is less of a priority and endurance is critical. So let's take a look at the type 2A fibers next. They're more of an intermediate fast twitch fiber. Type 2A fibers essentially serve as a bridge between the slow twitch type 1 fibers and the more rapid type 2X fibers. They have a faster contraction speed compared to type 1 fibers, and they can both use oxidative and glycolytic metabolism. Oxidative metabolism, also known as aerobic metabolism, and glycolytic metabolism, also known as anaerobic metabolism. Glycolytic metabolism would be using more glucose for energy, and then oxidative, as we discussed with the type 1 fibers, would be using oxygen for energy. This duality of being able to use these two different energy sources allows them to be more versatile, allowing them to support activities of a moderate intensity that require a balance between strength and endurance. They contain a moderate amount of mitochondria and a moderate amount of myoglobin. This renders them a bit less fatigue resistant than the type 1 fibers, but they're still more resistant to fatigue than the type 2X fibers. Examples of some activities that you might use a type 2A fibers would be middle distance running, so not really endurance or not really sprinting, and also activities such as your standard bodybuilding type workout where someone's using 12 to 15 repetitions, or they might be doing things like drop sets, you know, things that require a relatively high repetition range, which is going to need both endurance and strength style properties to be able to do those higher repetition sets. Our last type of muscle fiber are the type 2X fibers, which are a purely fast twitch muscle fiber. And these type 2X fibers are designed for quick and powerful bursts of activity. They rely predominantly on anaerobic glycolytic metabolism, which means that they're using glucose as their primary energy source rather than oxygen. They're far generally less abundant within the muscle. These type 2X fibers also contain fewer mitochondria and far less myoglobin than the other muscle fiber types, which makes them a lot more pale in color. While they can generate really high force outputs, they also fatigue really quickly. They're primarily activated during high intensity and short duration activities, like sprinting for example, or Olympic weightlifting, where rapid and forceful contractions are really important. On the Bodyworks Prime website, I've wrote an article about the different types of muscle fibers, and this table you can see on screen here, that's from that article. So if you want to read the full article, I'll put a link in the description box below. You can go and click on that and give it a read. And having that extra source of information as well is really going to help retain this information. So I do recommend you go and read that as well if you're trying to memorize all of this info. But this table right here is really useful just to quickly compare the properties of the different types of muscle fibers. So if you want to take a closer look at that, just pause the video now before I move on so you can carry on looking at it. So let's discuss how much muscle fiber type actually matters in real world situations. Should you adjust your training based on your muscle fiber type to get better performance? Well, we'll start off by first discussing whether you can determine your muscle fiber type in the first place. And honestly, there's no foolproof method that you can use to pinpoint your exact muscle fiber type. you might find online, or if you go to the gym, you might have a personal trainer who tells you that you can do a certain test where you pick up a weight and do a certain amount of repetitions with this weight, and then they'll use that to classify your muscle fiber type. However, these tests just mainly reveal the current training adaptations which you already have. So if we have someone who does a lot of running, for example, or endurance-based activities, then they're going to have adaptations that already make them more endurant. So of course, they're going to do better on this test in terms of getting more repetitions. But if we have someone who's a strength athlete and we get them to do this test, they're going to have made lots of adaptations to become stronger, in which case they're not going to be able to get as many repetitions because their training focus is strength. So these type of tests just actually tell us the training focus of the person. And if the person was to change their training focus, so if we had the endurance athletes start doing lots of strength work, then they would become stronger and have less of a capacity to handle endurance work. Likewise, if we got the strength athletes who just start doing loads of endurance work, they're going to become more endurant, and then they're going to get more repetitions on this test. So this test is pretty unreliable. And then we get down to things like muscle biopsies, which are obviously out of the reach for most people because they're really, really expensive and really, really challenging to be able to get access to. So say someone goes down and they take this muscle biopsy from you, all that's going to tell you is that that particular section of the muscle that they've taken the biopsy from has a certain distribution of a certain muscle fiber type. But you could just move a few millimeters away with the biopsy and you might find in a completely different muscle fiber arrangement. So again, that's quite an unreliable test in terms of just determining what type of muscle fiber composition you might have. And to make things even more challenging, the type of muscle fibers which you have are going to vary between different muscles in your body. So you might have one muscle that has more fast twitch fibers, and then another muscle which has more slow twitch fibers. And that's going to vary between different people based on genetics and all sorts of other things as well. Now, I just want to point out here that I'm not bashing on muscle biopsies. They are really, really useful and they're used a lot in various different types of research. However, what I am trying to say here is that if you're going to get a muscle biopsy done, getting that single biopsy isn't going to tell you whether you're a fast twitch or slow twitch dominant individual in terms of all of the muscles in your body collectively. Now, one thing I would say is that individuals who have a large amount of type 2 fibers, especially in regards to type 2X fibers, are more prone to muscle fatigue and also potentially central nervous system fatigue as well. The reason for that is, as I mentioned earlier, type 2 fibers are more glycolytic, and in this case, they're less able to defend themselves against calcium ions. Now, what calcium ions are something which is released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum of the muscle cell, and that release of calcium ions is part of what causes the muscles to contract. However, when it comes to the type 2 fibers, and especially the type 2X fibers, they're less easily able to remove this calcium ion from the cell. In a type 1 fiber, for example, they're going to be quite easily able to remove these calcium ions for it to be reuptook and put back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. In the type 2 fibers, this is a lot more challenging for those cells, mostly due to their glycolytic nature. The increased accumulation of calcium ions within these type 2 fibers is going to cause the activation of an enzyme called calpains. And these enzymes essentially damage or degrade proteins in the area. So, you know, you have your contractile proteins, myosin and actin, that have to pull against each other essentially to cause that muscle contraction. Even they can become affected by these enzymes that are released. And these enzymes aren't a bad thing, it's just part of the process of how the muscle works. So it's nothing to be scared of or anything like that. This isn't something that's, you know, a terrible thing that happens. It's just part of how the muscles work. But the reason why I'm telling you about this is to explain that if you're a person with a lot of fast twitch muscle fibers, especially the type 2X variety, you might find that you need more days to recover before you can train the same muscle group again, compared to someone else who's maybe got a lot of type 1 fibers. So in terms of determining whether you have a lot of fast twitch or slow twitch fibers, how many days recovery you need between your resistance training sessions to match the performance or exceed your performance is going to be a slight indicator of whether you have more fast twitch or slow twitch fibers. So if, for example, you trained your quadriceps and you need quite a lot of days compared to your average person before you can train them again and see performance improvements, then potentially that could be an indicator that you have a higher predominance of fast twitch fibers within your quadriceps. But that's just presuming that all of your other training variables are working perfectly. So, you know, you've got adequate sleep, recovery, nutrition, you've got a good training regime, you're not doing too much within that workout as well, because if you do like 30 sets for quadriceps, for example, in a single workout, of course that's going to mean that you need more recovery days because you've caused an extreme amount of muscle damage by doing that. But even within this hypothetical scenario, which we've just discussed here, I'd argue that determining the type of muscle fiber composition you have is largely irrelevant when it comes to actually making progress in your sports performance or the gym. The reason for this is because you can record what's happening in your training, as we've just discussed with the person with their quadriceps who wasn't making any improvements. The person recorded what was happening in their training, they noted that their performance wasn't improving, they added an extra rest day, and then their performance started increasing again. So whether their fast twitch or slow twitch didn't really matter. What mattered was that they accurately recorded their training and then they made a sensible adjustment to their training routine, which is what allowed them to continue making progress. And fundamentally, that's what good training comes down to. It doesn't really matter about trying to figure out whether you have fast twitch or slow twitch fibers. It's going to be really hard to figure that out in the first place. And even if you did, by the time you found out, you may as well have just recorded all your training and made adjustments to your training routine in the first place, and then you'd be seeing some of the best progress that you could achieve anyway. So it's really nothing to worry about, but it is really interesting to understand the types of muscle fibers and how they respond to training. So I hope you've enjoyed this video or you found it helpful. And if you have, you know which buttons to press. Press that like. Press that subscribe if you'd like to see more videos like this. And thanks very much for watching, everyone. I'll see you all next time.